My involvement in this event is meaningful to me because I'm so sure that every time we look around, we only see part of a story. There's a history behind whatever we are seeing in the present, and I'm so pleased to be able to help out in inviting back a speaker who offers us a tremendously rich view of history that informs the present. We're welcoming back Tom White, Mr. Thomas M. White, who is the Educational Outreach Coordinator at the Cohen Center for Holocaust Studies at Keene State University. Mr. White has received an MA, a Master of Arts teaching history from Keene State, and then he went on to teach high school for 16 years at Keene State High. And I'd like to just tell you a few of the accomplishments that he created at that time, because they bring history to the students, to the young ones who need to be the ones to carry on some of these important traditions and stories. He was active, he produced some new courses, AP European History and Sociology of the Holocaust there. He co-founded and directed a tour of the former Soviet Union. He co-wrote a two-year course on world perspectives for the high school, and he was named to the list of who's who in American teaching three times, 1994, 96, and 98. Now, in his role as outreach coordinator for the Holocaust Center, he presents nationally and regionally on Holocaust matters. He's active in producing materials and helping curriculum development in the public schools in New England. And he also keeps a very active website, which at this moment, because perhaps it reminds us of the Holocaust, is focusing on the crisis in Darfur with materials and background information and talking points for letters to legislators. So these are just a few of the ways in which Tom is bringing history into the present and enriching New England with all that he knows and is able to do for us. And so I'm very happy to welcome him back. The title, as you can see, of the new talk today, Between Dignity and Despair, Jewish Life in Nazi Germany from 1933 to 1938. Please welcome Tom White.
Thank you, Kit, and thank you, Saul, and everyone else involved. I have never been as welcomed, as friendly as I have been at Greenfield Community College, and I just want to say thank you for the way I've been treated each time I come here, so thank you very, very much. The topic is behind me, and often when I do this, and this is really for me because I travel quite a bit, I'd like to just take one moment, if you would, to have silence, just to reflect upon the enormity of what we're going to try to approach in the brief time we have together. And with the imagery behind me, one, of course, taken by a Jewish family, one taken by the Nazis, we have a real contrast of imagery, but we need to sort of ground ourselves first in what we're approaching. So just join me for a moment of silence first before we begin, which will help me ground myself as well. And I thank you. We are, as was mentioned, we are trying to deal with Darfur right now. I have information on the table before you leave. Please pick that up before you go. What we're looking here is something that took place in the past, but it is the past. It is done. It has happened. We need to be active today, right now, with the lessons that we learn from a presentation like this. Let us begin. I'm going to start right away. In my presentation today, we need to sort of forget what we already know. We know the Nazis evolved into a genocidal society. We know the Holocaust was the end result of that. They did not know that in 1933. Including Hitler himself could not envision how things would evolve over the next coming years. What we do know is you had a leader filled with hatred who was telling his children to hate. We knew that the Jewish question was foremost on his mind and that things would evolve due to circumstances and priorities. In a certain direction. It was not inevitable, but it evolved in that direction. So we have to forget what we know and put ourselves back in 1933 to see what the people back then knew, what they saw, how they evaluated information coming at them. And that's what I try to do with this. The direction of Nazi policies in the 1930s appeared obvious to those who suffered it only in retrospect. And we often find ourselves in the same position. So we need to sort of, we now know the warning signs, we now know the steps that lead to certain behaviors, and now are aware of that. They were not aware of that in 1933. We need to look very closely, not just simply at the Nazi government, which ironically enough in the first early years, 33 to 38, was reacting to what was going on the ground in local villages, mayoral meetings that were taking place in different districts in Germany. And the national government almost reacts in response to the initiatives from below. We cannot ignore what happened on the ground with everyday Germans. We need to look closely at how from 33 to 38 into 41, the social exclusion of a group of people who were German, who did not have any ethnic difference by and large with the community, where Germans had been there for hundreds of years, how they gradually became excluded and segregated over time. And as we look at that exclusion of social death, we now will know that that will lead, of course, to the ultimate death of what was the Holocaust. And for our people we're talking about today, which are the Jewish families living through this experience in 1933 to 38, there were mixed messages that did not make the so-called writing on the wall very clear until 1938. When 1938 happens and Kristallnacht happens, it becomes very clear. Until that point, there were messages that seemed to suggest other outcomes. So that's what I want to look at today. I start with a Jewish family taken in 1928. I often use imagery, but I can't really discuss how and why. But as you'll notice, it's at any occasion, like we'll have some kind of dress-up event, the kids fooling around on the front, that kind of thing. And I like this photograph because it's not taken by the Nazis. It's pre-Hitler. This is a Jewish family before Hitler is given power in 33. And it also gives you a sense of maybe gender roles a little bit, which is my topic today. You should know that only two people in this group will survive the Holocaust. And the image here, you know, I was talking about photographs. Here's an image of a family who did not expect what was coming their way. Clearly, they're taking photographs to remember because the future will be full of hope as we take photographs in the same light. Today, when we focus on gender, which, by the way, is a very important, interesting study because the Nazis would approach the topic via gender. The Nazis were very male dominant. They saw Jewish males as a threat, not necessarily Jewish females. In fact, in society, they acted in a very similar way. And we'll look at how that broke down. But along the stations toward extinction, each gender lived its own journey. Ultimately, the journey ends the same way. But what happened were different messages. Women would see things much differently than men because their experiences tended to be much different in the early years. January 1933, Hitler named a chancellor in a backdoor plot that got him in. He was not elected by the German people, but through a backdoor maneuvering was appointed. And here he is coming to power with those around him. And immediately torchlight parades, instant assaults on opponents, tortures, murders will follow soon after. And yet here are our Jewish families in Germany. And you'll see, I think, why I like this imagery. I think I often ask people, when you think of Jews and the Holocaust, what do you think of? And immediately the stereotypical images come forward, the Orthodox or Hasidic Jews from Eastern Europe. And yet if you look at these people here, there's nothing that distinguishes them at all as a religion. They, in fact, are Germans, assimilated in society. And how do they assess what's going on around them? Are they at threat? We now know, looking back, of course they were at threat. But did they see it or realize it in 1933? Mixed signals of fear, menace, hope, and encouragement. Example, in school, these families would have gone to school with people who had become the local Gestapo chief. And one day when a family member perhaps got beaten up on the street by a brown shirt, they would go right away to their friend who was in charge of Gestapo headquarters and say, "What's going on?" And the Gestapo chief would say, "Well, listen, Louise, you know, don't worry. It'll be okay." Well, how bad could it be if your classmate is running Gestapo and is still talking to you? So you had this sense of bad things are happening to some people by other people, but I know other people is my classmates, you know, who are going to watch out for me. It really won't be that bad. You had very mixed signals, not only mixed signals from individuals, but from the government itself. And so as these people were trying to navigate the space in which they lived, you would see from 33 to 38, relatively few initiatives from the national government. you would have the Nuremberg Laws of 35. But most of the initiatives would come from local towns and mayors. It isn't until 38 that there's a coordinated sense of how to deal with the Jewish question in Nazi Germany via the government. February 1933, the Reichstag catches on fire. Immediately, the Nazis, and Hitler was a master at this, takes advantage of a situation that's presented to him and immediately says it is a communist plot to undermine the democracy. Well, of course, please don't laugh because Hitler was not an advocate of democracy, but he, of course, could use a moment to his advantage. And what did he do that night? Remember, at this point, Hitler's latest party polls, the November 32 elections before he's named chancellor, he had lost 2 million votes, his party had, in the recent elections. Germans were beginning to figure out what the Nazis were all about. Hitler could only, you know, contradict himself so many times to different groups before those groups began to talk to each other. And they began to sort of sense what the Nazis were about. Then comes the Reichstag fire. At that moment, he says the nation is in crisis, we are under attack, and fear becomes his mantra. Immediately, the next day, civil rights are taken away for all Germans. Under the guise of, we are under direct and imminent threat of a communist revolution. Now, why would that be so important for Germans in 1933? The Soviets had just had their revolution in 1917. St. Petersburg is 2,000 miles away from Berlin. There was great fear in Germany of a communist revolution. In fact, there had been evidence of one, the Spartacist Rebellion at the end of the First World War. The fact that the Communist Party was the second largest political party to the Nazis in 1932. There was great fear, especially amongst those becoming policemen in this era. Hermann Göring, who would become the chief of police in Prussia, would begin to present evidence that, in fact, the communists are plotting the overthrow of the government. So the fear was legitimate, they thought, and the government would, of course, play on this fear with the Reichstag fire as the clear evidence. The police gain extraordinary powers immediately with the Reichstag fire decrees that follow. You'll notice here a brown shirt with a white armband on. This is a SA brown shirt who's been deputized a policeman. And immediately the police, who of course were undermanned, undertrained, underfunded in the Depression, suddenly have brown shirted troopers helping them police the streets, looking for communists, looking for people who are a threat to the government. And of course, they have very little police training, so their preferred method, of course, was simply just beating people up or killing them or doing whatever they might do. The first targets that get arrested after the Reichstag fire decrees, I think, give an illustration of where the state is going and what their focuses were. So I'm going to put the list up here of people who, as I put here, were okay to dislike and even hate in Nazi Germany. And I put this up as a warning for us. Because oftentimes, we're going to look back in history and say, what happened to those people by the Germans was terrible. And yet, really reject any responsibility that we have for our own prejudices. Watch the list that goes up. Because they're under imminent communist revolution, homeless people are arrested. Now, that makes some kind of sense, right? Homeless people might join the Communist Party. But it also had racial overtones, because the Nazis were believing in a racial system. For many of these Nazis, they believed that if you were unemployed or homeless, it was a reflection of genetics, that there was something in your gene pool that made you lazy. So you have sort of a dual thing going on here of, yes, maybe a political threat, but also a racial threat. Although the meanings are always convoluted. Communists get rounded up, of course, by the police and the SA. Liberals, or those who believe, you know, in these things about everybody is created equal, that flies smack in the face of a racist ideology and were considered a threat. Homosexuals or asocials, people who are deemed, again, a threat to the state. Gypsies, homeless people, handicapped people, Hitler's actual primary first target. In a racial state, he thought people who were physically or mentally handicapped are a drain to the gene pool of the race. And if, as Hitler projected, he would like to build the country up for war, handicapped people posed a direct threat to the gender, to the lifeblood of the state. So handicapped people began to get rounded up, along with Jehovah's Witnesses, whose crime was not to swear loyalty to the leader, but not the Führer yet, but of course to Hitler the person. Jehovah's Witnesses, of course, become martyrs in the true sense of the word. They could have simply said, "We, you know, Heil Hitler, and we were loyal to the Führer." They refused to, in most cases, and were killed for that simple religious belief. And the others, of course, become a patchwork of people who will suffer throughout this next coming years. When you look at this list, I often remind people, who on this list would we have stood up for in 1933 Germany if we were Germans? Would we have stood up for communists and homosexuals? In a society that Hitler was saying, and why he was becoming popular, that has become soft, corrupt. It has art has somehow been mutated into grotesqueness. And we need to sort of clean up society morally, spiritually, and purify us. All these were threats to that world, that beautiful world of Aryan Germany that Hitler and the Nazis are trying to project. How many of us would stood up for any of these groups then, or I would argue even today? And you can pick whatever group you would like. And when it came push to shove, who would stand up for a group like that? As we continue here. Oh, that last one, and again, to think about it, of course, these people were all arrested not because of anything they had done, even though the Nazis arrested them under the guise of the Reichstag fire decrees. They were arrested simply for who they were, not for what they had done. How is Hitler perceived in 1933 and 1934 by the public? Well, we have the propaganda that tries to show you how he wanted to be perceived. And the perception that we have here, if you're a Christian, Germany was a Christian country, you have a sense of what the appeal will be. Almost like the Savior coming from heaven, taking all the burdens on his own shoulders to save the country. It's very much a male-dominant movement, as you can see. And the swastika here, the Hakenkreuz, turned on its side as if it's going forward, and Hitler, of course, will lead you forward. Very much the knight on horseback. And why I show you these images here is that, again, we have to forget what we know. How is Hitler projecting himself, and how would he later be perceived, or maybe even justified or rationalized by people? He was being rationalized as a virtuous moral leader who was taking on all the evils of society and cleaning them up and making them better for us. In fact, by 1938, although it's rather dubious, he's Time's Man of the Year, not because by itself he's a great leader, but it just shows you that here's a man who's gaining sort of eminence, not only on the German stage, but also on the international stage, as a man to be reckoned with. And in Germany, you know what? We need a man who can be reckoned with to clean up our society from all the ills that it's now facing in 1933 and 34. The first popular magazines that come out, you know, today we have, I'm not sure what they are. My wife used to tell me when she was young, they had Teen Beat and this kind of stuff, right, of pop stars. But the first actual sort of germination of this is Nazi Germany, because Hitler comes to power with about 70% of the electorate not voting for his party. And he was very concerned every day that he would lose his power. He really saw himself almost like the Kaiser, who might lose his power, you know, throw him out of office at any time. And so the propaganda machine began. Who was the real Hitler? Books came out, right? Know the real Hitler. Magazines came out like this you would see all the time. And imageries of Hitler was like this, not in uniform, but reading on a sunny day with his dog. And when you hear things, you know, isn't this the guy who's promoting violence on the street against communists? Aren't his brown shirts just randomly beating people up and undermining the law? Imagery would come out like this, it would be confusing to people. This was the real Hitler, a quiet, hardworking man taking all the troubles of Germany under his own shoulders. He's going to be quick to distance himself from the brown shirts because they become a political liability to him. Most Germans want law and order. That's what he has promised the country, to bring us back to a decent place. The brown shirts that actually got him into power, and one of the reasons, become an embarrassment to him as they keep breaking the law and keep beating people up on the streets. So he would project this image. Now I show you these kind of things only because imagine yourself being a Jew in 1933. The majority of the males of age who could have served in the First World War had served their country in the front line trenches. They are very patriotic and they're confronting their country's problems as all other Germans are. How would you perceive Hitler in 1933? If you'll notice, Hitler had not arrested Jews. Unless they happen to be communists, right? But they weren't being arrested for being Jews in 33, by and large because they were assimilated Germans. I think more they believe they were assimilated more than they actually were. But in many cases, Jews reading this saying, who is Hitler? Should we be afraid of him? Many read Mein Kampf and knew right away, here's a guy to be reckoned with. This is a guy who's going to be kind of scary. But the public image sort of went against what people were rumoring about him, a Jewish family. Let's talk about Hitler's Jewish vision, I suppose. The Jewish question. Really took a four-stage process. This is sort of a simplification, only because we need to think in those terms, I think. One step will kind of blur into the other. There's no real clear distinction as to when one step happened and when the other did. But the four-stage process took place would take place throughout the country at different rates, at different speeds, depending where you were. In some parts of Germany, you would have very little support for the Nazi Party. In other parts of Germany, you would have, you know, terrific support for any initiative that they would conjure up. So identification became the first level of this. Who are Jews? How do you do that? Of course, one of the things they would do is to talk to the local churches and produce baptismal records from local towns. Sort of by default, they would find out who was baptized in a certain parish, and if a certain person wasn't baptized, the questions would become, are they Jewish? And so the churches would provide this information. They didn't have to, they did, because that was their quote-unquote patriotic duty to give the leader what he wants. But identification became a real problem, because Hitler's thinking not in religious terms, but in racial terms. Literally, he believes, and the Nazis believe, those who are believers in this thing, that if you actually cut the skin of a Jew, you take his blood sample, it will not have human blood. It will be a different race. And they actually try to identify the Jewish blood type. And of course, they couldn't. And from the very beginning, they knew that race was a fallacy. It didn't matter. They were still going after the Jews. And what you find out in the early stage of identification, they did it by religion, because they couldn't do it by race, even though that is what they were trying to do. And then came expropriation, taking things away. Then came concentrating them. And that basically means segregating them out of society, putting them in another place, right? And by that point, the annihilation begins. This process in Germany takes a very long time. Hitler comes in 33, January of 33. The Holocaust is not state policy until October of 1941. And it's only in 41 when German Jews start to get deported to the East. To that point, there's all kinds of persecution, but there are also a degree of, they are German Jews, we can't deal with them the same way we would deal with Polish Jews or Eastern European Jews. You must really understand, I think, this crucial point that there is no coordinated Jewish policy until after Kristallnacht of 38. What you really have in Germany is Hitler sort of setting the tone. We don't like Jews, we need to take them on. But he really was focused on other things as well. Securing his power, that meant getting rid of political opponents. Building the army up for war, which took a tremendous effort. He really couldn't focus on the Jewish question yet. But all the agencies under his control, whether it be the Brown House party headquarters, whether it be the Foreign Office, whether it be, and you can list all the different organizations, all of them try to come up with their own Jewish policy. And they actually competed with one another to try to get Hitler's favor. And how Hitler sort of ran the show, he kind of ran it in a social Darwinistic way. Everybody competed under him. The idea that came to the top, that looked most credible, he would eventually give the green light to. So he let everybody fight it out amongst themselves, and at the end, he would approve a certain direction when he considered the question. But it's not until after Kristallnacht that the government actually coordinates it as a centralized policy. So the regime's cruel intentions came drip by drip, rather like an anesthetic. You know, on one hand, you would have persecution here, and then you'd have a law passed by another group that would almost contradict that same law. It became very confusing. In some places, some of the laws that were passed weren't enforced. There were provisos. If you're a World War I veteran, you're exempt from this persecution. That because President Hindenburg had told Hitler, stop persecuting my Jewish veterans. If you were a relative of someone who had fallen in the First World War, you too were exempt. So you had all these laws being passed, and at the same time, all these exemptions being passed. And if you're Jewish and a veteran, it was very mixed signals here. What is actually going on? German Jews as a percent of the population. I always bring this up because I think we let the Nazis sort of frame our memories. Hitler will talk about a war against the Jew as if it's a single entity. That they had all kinds of power over banks, you know. They stabbed us in the back in the First World War, all these kind of things. Curiously enough, the German army in 1916, long before Hitler, had done a survey of troops in the front lines to find out if any Jews were serving. Someone had suggested Jews weren't really serving. And the survey actually came out, the German army survey found out that the majority of Jewish men were in fact on the front lines, and the report was buried. No one knew about it. So you had this kind of thing going on even before Hitler's time. Population, less than 1%. is Jewish. Of that 0.75%, about a third of those live in Berlin, which is why Hitler could not stand Berlin. It was a cosmopolitan city. He preferred Nuremberg, which was, of course, almost nothing like Berlin. It didn't have the percentage of Jews that Berlin had. As for a figure of the population, it's about 505,000 people out of 67 million. So this was the group that was trying to figure out what was going on, and they had almost no power whatsoever. To reinforce that today, in the world, Jews make up about half a percentage point of the world's population. And when, of course, people talk about, well, don't they still control the banks? They control the media. You hear all this stuff today still. Well, I did a little checking, of course. You got to do that. And the facts will tell you that today in America, of all American private and commercial banks, about 3% are run by Jews, which means about 97% of the banks are run, by and large, by Christians, by Protestants. When's the last time you heard somebody say, those Lutherans love money. They control the banks, right? So you have this still sense of anti-Semitism in the air. April 1st, 1933 is a good illustration of what I'm about to try to deal with here. The brown shirt leader said, Hitler, you've been in power for a few months. We need to take on the Jews. Hitler said, I can't do that yet. If I do that, it's a political bombshell on me because people are rejecting me as a leader if I become one who's overtly anti-Jewish. It played in some circles, but it by and large didn't play throughout all of Germany politically. In fact, he's trying to make himself look like a decent leader of the people. But he says, before he leaves Berlin, why don't you guys on April 1st have a boycott? He gives the orders, never written, and then leaves town. On April 1st, the SA show up in front of shops and put up signs, don't shop here, right, Jewish shops, the whole bit. And Hitler, in a way, is sort of placating the group that got him into power. Hitler is very attuned to the SA, the brown shirt. They share the same sort of ideology, the same outlook. But he begins to realize quickly what a dangerous group they are for his own political power. Because what happens on April 1st, by and large, although there are places where this didn't happen, Germans, by and large, ignore the boycott. This came out of nowhere. And you had German World War I veterans sitting in front of their shops wearing their medals saying, you know, who are these thugs, these SA thugs? And by and large, Germans ignored these SA thugs and went shopping. And the boycott was an ultimate failure. That night, due to a couple of things. One, you're in a depression. The last thing you want to do is hurt business. Overseas, word came in that they're going to have a counter boycott on Germany because of this persecution in Germany. And Hitler thought that may not be too good for the economy. Plus, he knew here was a card he played that didn't really work. And he calls off the boycott. He publicly cancels the boycott, but then gives signs to everybody else to continue the boycotts, and they do continue through the coming months. Publicly, he says, and the boycott, but then gives unofficial word to continue them. So the unofficial boycotts continue. These are SA troopers marching through Leipzig. Yeah, here they are carrying again Jewish businessmen rounded up. You see the crowds looking here, and there's a sense in some places in Germany that on April 1st, they went out and they helped their neighbors. But you know what? On April 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, we have our lives to lead. We can't come out every day and stop the persecution of our neighbors. We have to make our living, we have to go to work, etc. And so you had this momentum continuing from the brown shirts, but not officially from the government, which made the situation very hard to read and react to. September 33, Goebbels takes over the Chamber of Culture and immediately says that Jews are excluded from all cultural life. They can't be in orchestras, they can't go to movies, that kind of thing. Okay, then people say, look, the government is now taking direct action. But look what had happened before he makes this announcement. German Boxing Association expels amateur champion Eric Selig in April of 33 because he was Jewish. Selig later resumed his boxing career in the US. What you have happening on the local level, local groups, local clubs began banning their own Jews because they know that's what Hitler stands for, and on their own initiative they began doing this. It happened rapidly overnight. And the government seized the momentum and began to try to steer it in their direction. And so Goebbels comes out and talks about Jews being removed from life, but by and large that was already happening in many places in Germany. German Jewish reaction to being excluded from cultural life. Red flag, right? We're being kicked out of cultural life. You know, but times are tough. And what do? Like all of us, I think, would have done. The German Frontline Veteran Association began to organize their own cultural events, their own sporting events, and kept life going. You simply react to what was put in front of you. Jews are passive in all of this, right? No. They're living in a dynamic that they don't understand, nor did anyone else, and they do what the next best thing they can do. They create their own social life. It's at that point you start seeing a new trend. The April 1st boycott was an embarrassment to Hitler and the Nazis. It was aggressive. It was in your face. There was no legal justification for it, and most Germans rejected it as lawless. And so they begin to figure it out. If you put the aura of law onto things, Germans might respect that a little bit more and tend to follow what's expected of them. And so the legal system begins getting involved, and you have cartoons like this coming out that's sort of replacing the brown shirt on the street on April 1st with a more legalized approach. It's interesting, if you've seen the series Auschwitz, Inside the Nazi State, that was on PBS last month, they have an interview of a member of an SS brigade who was shooting Jews in the Eastern Front. And he will say, you know, I did this, I shot people in Poland because those Jews took over my farm back in Germany. Well, of course, if you look at the propaganda, he's telling you historical memory, not fact. He is telling you exactly what he was conditioned to believe back then. And as one person said, well, if they killed, you know, took over your farm in Germany, why were you killing them in Poland? He said, but they were Jews. They would grow up and hurt us, you know. So you have this sort of mixture of memory that isn't quite real, but based on the sense that the law system was saying what you could and could not do, and what was right, what was wrong. An example, April 7th. 1 week after the boycott that failed, you have legislation that comes in, which is cleverly called the Law for the Restoration of the Professional Civil Service, which talks about, doesn't say specifically Jews, but that's the actual goal of this particular law, was to get Jews out of civil service. In Germany, that was everything from postal service guy to teacher. It had a wide range of connotations. Civil servants are forced to prove that, this is how they did it, their Aryan descent. Not their Jewish descent, prove your Aryan descent. And so, of course, genealogists would make a killing. You would say, prove that I'm in fact not Jewish, trace my family roots back for X number of years, and they would. Now imagine, you have a friend in the genealogical department who's tracing back your roots, and you find out you have a Jewish grandmother. A little money goes a long way to erase that grandmother on your chart, right? So these genealogists were making a killing. They were producing documents. Many of them were forged, and people began to protect themselves. In this case, what was interesting about the civil service decree is that World War I veterans, as I mentioned, or those who had close relatives who had died in the war were exempt from legislation. So what you had was an actual law from the national government, but in many cases not enforced because of these exemptions, and in other cases enforced by the local people because they could care less about the exemption and were anti-Semitic anyway. When people say, how do they identify the Jews, it was done locally. You could pass a law that says attack Jews, but that doesn't really mean anything because who's a Jew? Local people who knew that who they were, who wanted their job or didn't like them, began to act on their own initiative using this as a justification. Similar laws are passed in the following years, weeks and years that will affect other occupations. So you have this German Jewish family walking down the street. You see the infamous Star of David on them. And I often ask people who I present this to, when do you think this photograph was taken? And the assumption often is that Hitler came to power in 33, scapegoated Jews for the problems of Germany, attacked them right away. If that was true and he did it that way, Hitler would never have been in power. He would never have kept his power. He would have been seen as an aggressive leader, taking away the rights of fellow Germans who have served in the First World War. The badge itself is one of the last things that comes in this road to social death. By the time you get to the branding or the wearing of the star, Jews are already socially dead, removed from society, removed from culture, so this is simply a badge that says, you know, we've completed our task. You should know the branding will take place after about 2,000 laws have been passed. Many of these are obscure, many of these are bizarre, many of these contradict others. They come from all kinds of different organizations and directions, not coordinated until 1938. And one of the last series of laws, of course, was the branding of September of 41, 2 years into the Second World War, is when the branding takes place. And by then, Jews are socially dead. You should know that when Hitler was offered, he was asked to do this a number of times, and he kept saying, no, the Germans aren't ready yet. And after the decree came out in 41, there was actually some rumbling saying, this isn't right. And Hitler said, I made a mistake. I should have waited longer, but oh well, it's done. just a story of a woman, and I always like to do is when I show a law or talk about something that was perpetrated against somebody, it's always good to hear from those whose rights were violated. And so I often throw stories up like this of a young girl whose father loses her job, his job, as a lawyer, I believe this one was a lawyer, and had to leave the country. And as you look at these laws evolving, in fact, I'll get to this at the end, I'm going to save my comments to that, you'll see that lives are affected in very simplistic ways. If you lose your job, you can't pay the mortgage. And thus, you've got to sell your house, and thus go to a poorer part of town. The process of segregation begins with these laws being passed. All right, how do you define a Jew? If the first set of laws are trying to define who a Jew is, how do you do it? You have this sort of stereotype on the gift plots or the poisonous mushroom textbook that many children would read in Nazi Germany. You have the red, this is you see the Jew with the Star of David, and I suggest that has to be there because, you know, what Jew looks like this, what human being looks like this. The red is actually an old tradition in Christianity that Judas and others are always depicted with red hair. It was considered an evil sign. So anybody with red hair, right? So you have these red-haired images of Jews. If you open the book of the gift plots, you're going to see a couple of interesting things of how you begin to isolate Jews. Hitler lived in a Christian society that for thousands of years believed that Christ was killed by Jews. In fact, in Mel Gibson's recent film, the same implication exists. And it's now coming back with a vengeance. And so, children, don't forget, the Jews killed Christ. Well, of course, to put this straight, for those who don't know the history, of course, the Romans killed Christ. They were very jealous of torture. That was their preferred way. And who do they crucify? A guy from Galilee who was a potential rebel at the High Holy Days, where you had the city of Jerusalem expanding in terrific ways, celebrating a holiday that was their liberation from Egypt. It was a volatile time. The Romans dealt with a guy. They crucified him, as they did thousands of other Jews at the same time, okay? But good German children who are good Christians are reminded about their history because in the texts, in the Gospels, that were written, what, 70 to 125 years after the events, there is impregnated in them historical experience talking about Jews as the enemy. And so you have this sort of, to bank on if you're the Nazis. But also in this book, you have this kind of racial overtone. Note the male-female stuff. This was very big for the Nazis. The idea of the Jewish male preying on the female, the innocent female, especially from a profession, which of course is going to underline what they're trying to do here, getting them out of the professions. You had imagery like this as well, which is more racial. This is produced by, actually I forget who produced this one. I think it was VSS produced this one. And you see this sort of scientific overtone of race, of the good and bad race. So you see this mixture of things. And yet, where does Hitler stand in all this? People see these initiatives. They see the SA beating people up in the streets. They see laws being passed and unpassed. Where does Hitler stand? Well, there are the image. Reading the paper, you know, he very rarely ever read the paper, but the public persona was a guy who cares so deeply but is so burdened by all the demands of the offices of state that he can't deal with all these things happening. That changes when Hitler makes a very clear and conscious choice to get rid of an embarrassing thorn in his side, the brown shirts. At this point, before, this is Ernst Röhm, who's the leader of the SA, a man who is saying, I want to become the new German army. The SA will become the new German army. We're a revolutionary army that will bring the end of communism and everything else. The traditional German army, the Reichswehr, very much rejected the brown shirts and were very afraid of them. But because of the Treaty of Versailles of 1918, 1919, their army was limited to 100,000 men. Hitler made a clear choice. He went to the German generals and he said, look, I will take out the brown shirts. I will take out their leaders if you support me. And the aristocrats and those of the traditional army that German society adored said yes. Take out Röhm and we will follow you. That's exactly what he does. Hitler will kill Röhm and many of the SA leadership. He will do it publicly. It will be reported in newspapers and the reaction in Germany is, what an awful act. But thank goodness someone has the courage to be our leader to get rid of this terrible plague on our society. The very plague Hitler had created in the first place. But he comes across as a man who's taking things on his own shoulders, a real leader. Okay, relative quiet follows as Hitler builds his power and builds his armed forces. So if you're a Jew, what do you see? The leadership of the SA taken out. The SA began to disappear off the streets in many cases because they're afraid of being, in getting in trouble with this new group that's emerging, the SS. You're a Jew, and in your town that doesn't have particular anti-Semitism, you see this happening, how do you read Hitler? He's a guy who's actually standing up for us. You could actually almost see them thinking that way. Of course, it didn't happen broadly that way, but they were thinking in terms of who was this Hitler. 50,000 Jews had fled Germany from 34 to 35. By 35, at least 10,000 come home. Refugees, it is not a nice life being a refugee. You go to a different country with a different language. You have no job skills. It becomes a very difficult place, especially when to places like France, which is not at all welcoming to Jews or Germans. Right? These were Germans trying to escape. So they come home. It's an interesting sign of what they are perceiving as happening. The propaganda, Hitler would never use the word Jew or Bolshevik separately. They're always together, the Judeo-Bolshevik conspiracy. Hitler believed that they're fighting this terrible plague on the world. And you'll notice sort of the Bolshevik here, but notice the Jewish stereotypes, preying on women. And this was very much a theme of Nazi Germany. An ethnic revival was taking place. Hitler would then promote the German mother, right? And I got to wrap it up because Saul is queuing me up. And I'm going to skip the sexual overtones and just get to, I think, one last slide so that you can see because our time is short. In fact, well, you know what I'll do? I'll probably stop there with the Allies and the Academy. One thing that reinforced everything the Nazis were doing was the fact that academics began to back them up. And when you had experts in the field talking about race and saying what the government is doing is legitimate, it's very difficult to fight that and say you're wrong when the best authorities in the country are supporting what you're doing. Okay, well, to summarize, basically, how were Jewish men and women reacting to this? Women saw the signs first. They were much more connected to local towns and societies than were the men, because they're the ones who are at home when the kids come home beaten up from school. When principals make an announcement saying, you know, it's okay to attack your Jewish classmates. The parents heard about it. They would go to local mayors or people they knew and say, what's going on? And they would see it. They would talk to their husbands, and again, gross generalizations, saying, we need to get out of here. This is serious. The male response, businessmen in many cases, right? When times are tough, you have to work harder. It's a very understandable mentality. As their clientele shrunk to Jewish clientele, they became more and more isolated what was going on around them. And Jewish women did sense it and said, we need to leave. Jewish women began to retrain, which men had a hard time doing because they'd invested their whole life into a certain business. They couldn't retrain as easily. But women began to retrain. They began to advocate getting out. And by 38, when Crystal Night hits and Jewish men are arrested, about 35,000 men, the Jewish women now desperately try to get them out and try to get the emigration going. But by 38, the world had sealed its borders. You couldn't get out. So there's a sense of the gender part I would like to spend time on. And now I'm done, and I'd like to field any questions. Questions that you have. I think you had the first question. Go ahead. Do you remember now?
Actually, I was just going to say that it wasn't just those particular people. There were also black people and others that were involved in that. You could ask out of that group there if we would see them. And I think that would have to be a personal decision for everyone because some people didn't stand up and some people went into hiding.
Yeah, she said there are other groups involved here as well, and the decision to stand up is a real personal one. And I think that's right, and I think partially that's the danger, because personally, you can always say, right, it doesn't affect me directly, and I have other things to do, which is the exact dynamic these people kind of bank on. And she's right, the Rhineland mixture of French troops with African troops that were sort of in the Rhineland area, Western Germany, was very much part of this propaganda too, the racial threat going on here, you're right. Other questions? Yes?
Well, I was from the beginning of your talk, I was curious. I see parallels to what's happening today in our household. I was wondering
if I'm going to close this door. I think you hear the questions. I have to. Somebody doesn't worry about security. So the question was, do I see parallels here? I have to be very careful. First of all, I think parallels that you see, if you're seeing them, you need to react to them. And you need to say, you know, I think there's something here that's really credible. When human rights are under attack, under a concept of fear, then I think it needs to be, you know, paid close attention to. When diversity of thought is not allowed, that needs to be paid close attention to. Clearly, this is not Nazi Germany of 1933. But are there things that scare us in what this administration is doing or what's happening in the world around us? Sure. We need to be attuned to it. Absolutely. What we're trying to do is to go on a larger level, what I mentioned about Darfur. All the signs are there. We now know it's a genocide. Our country has called it a genocide. We're obligated now to act under UN law, that we've treaties that we've signed, to act on this, and we're not. Although that's not quite fair, the last couple of weeks, the administration has begun to push the ball forward into reacting to what's going on in this genocide. But a whole lot more needs to be done, and that comes from us making things happen.
Well, what could an individual have done?
It's a great question. You know, what could an individual have done? One thing you must know is that the Nazis took daily popular opinion polls. Hitler was sort of the first politician who took those, and he acted in those polls. For example, the T4 program, which was the euthanasia program, quote unquote, of handicapped people. Protests broke out all across Germany, led by ministers and lawyers, that killing of handicapped people in gas chambers in German hospitals. There were 6 gas chamber hospitals before there was a Holocaust, was wrong. Protests broke out all across Germany during the war. Hitler publicly canceled the program, but privately it continued. So in 1941, we had about 70,000 people killed in these gas chambers, including 5,000 children. By the end of the war, it'd be about 200,000. So you had this public declaration, and then nothing much happened. So, you know, you can argue on one hand, you could have stood up to Hitler, and he could have told you what you wanted to hear, like the April 1st boycott is boycotted, is ended, and yet it still continues. I think you need to be aware that in 33, Hitler was very afraid of keeping, that he wasn't going to keep his power. And if a groundswell of people had now popped up, if there were alternates to what Hitler was saying, his credibility, especially in the academy, would not have happened. And those people would not have come forward for him. And in fact, I think it would have unraveled pretty quickly. In that, by and large, people didn't say much, especially when you had the aura of law behind it, which is a pseudo-law, then you had a momentum. It's not an easy question to answer, but too little was done. And that's probably not a satisfactory answer. But I think a momentum could have been stopped, because if people began to jump on the bandwagon, wouldn't have had there been an alternate view. But let's face it, there was incredible oppression at that time as well, under the fear of the Reichstag fire decrees.
I wonder, you said a few things about what would have happened if there had been a reaction that was negative to Hitler. At one point you said that if he had immediately attacked Jews, he would never stay in power. First of all, I find that extremely difficult to believe, given that some of the things that were happening had nothing to do with Hitler. The eugenics practices that were taking place were encouraged by him, but in fact the institutions where they were taking place were in conversation with other places in the world that were also practicing eugenics. It was what biologists and some medical people believed was in fact the correct way to deal with things. And I guess I'd like you to clarify, because the difficulty for me is not that you think that he would have been kicked out, but that by saying, if we had done this, this, and this, it would have worked this way. That seems to me as just as much of a fallacy as saying we know what they felt. We know, you know, if we're looking at it with hindsight now, we understand these things, because there have been a number of genocides since then. We've got one going on right now, if not more than one. And it doesn't matter what we know; it continues. On the ground, that's what's going on.
There are three things there. One, the eugenics program. Two, was my statement correct in saying that had he come out and attacked Jews right away, would he have been in trouble politically? And three, you know, what do we do today? Have we learned any lessons at all? So I'll try to answer them in that order. Eugenics was really in the 1930s in this country very popular. And it was seen very much as hygiene. In fact, today when you take a pill or something to stop a disease, back then they were thinking for public health, you need to stop things like Hodgkin's disease or these kind of terrible diseases. And the only way you could do that is to prevent offspring. So sterilization became the policy. In fact, 32 U.S. states were involved in the eugenics program. but it was initiated by states, not by the national government. In Germany, it radically changed. Yes, they looked at the US policies to get ideas. And under Hitler, you know, the ideas would go out and then people would sort of research. A lot of lawyers were involved. But what happened in Germany is quite different. There was a precedent in German universities to think this way anyway. And you had a chair of race appearing now in every university, in every organization. Clearly, from Hitler coming to power, right away we have him issuing orders, we want to get rid of the handicapped people. But he can't do it until 1939. When the invasion of Poland takes place, September 1st of 39, it's the next month, October, and the euphoria of victory, knowing the army has actually won, that he gives the orders directly to start killing people in the death hospitals.
Wait, what year are you saying that happened?
1941. To that point, sterilization had been the plan and had been practiced, but it becomes national state policy in 41 to gas them in gas chambers, or lethal injections, or starvation. And that becomes state policy from the Nazis. And I'm being told to wrap up. And again, it's illustrative, though, that Hitler wanted to attack the handicapped people right away. He couldn't do it because it would have backfired on him. He had to wait for the right circumstances, and that was the euphoria of victory. And the issues, when the orders went out, they were issued privately, not publicly. And then it was found out publicly. He then condemns the program publicly, but continues it privately. So it's a very difficult question for Jews, because when Hitler does attack Jews right away, or the SA, Hitler was very careful to distance himself from this question at first. When he does attack Jewish people right away, or the SA does, or party apparatus does, Hindenburg, the president, who had enormous respect in the country, tells him publicly to stop it, to knock it off. Which is why you have these provisos in these laws saying that World War I veterans are exempt, because Hitler is reacting to pressure from Hindenburg and from the army as well that was rejecting this little corporal who didn't know what he was talking about. So you had decent people who weren't going to stand for this. But when Hindenburg passes, and Hitler then gets the army behind him because of the Rom purge, now they're swearing loyalty to him directly, not to the Constitution, and then it becomes a different issue. He can act in much broader strokes than he had before. And I think I'm done. So I can answer any questions you would like down here before the science class comes in. Please take our things, our bookmarks, and if you want to be our mailing list, there's a mailing list thing right there that we can get you involved with. And thank you so much for your time.